Well, everybody, good morning to you again. So good to be with you. And, you know, I get the privilege of being able to share God's word most Sundays here. Every once in a while, we have the screen and, you know, Pastor Jeff Bucknam, who's our lead pastor over all of our Harvest campuses, you'll periodically hear from him as well. We want to just make sure that we open up God's word this morning. And so I want to invite you in your Bibles to turn to the book of Daniel to begin. So the book of Daniel, and if you're looking for a Bible, maybe you don't have one this morning, if you go below the seat in front of you, there's some shelves that are there, and you will find a Bible there, and you can turn to page 738 if you're not sure where the book of Daniel is. I believe page 738 will take you there, and then we'll be in the book of Daniel. You know, we live in a time where people are experiencing, I would say, a significant increase of angst and anxiety in our world. Wouldn't you agree? I mean, you look around and you see all the things that are going on. For example, we watch the news, right? I mean, if you do that, maybe you're a bit of a news junkie. You'll watch the news, and the anxiety that can be created by watching the news is astounding. I mean, we watch and we hear about ongoing conflicts, don't we? Between Russia and Ukraine, or China and Taiwan, and what will develop there possibly, and Israel with Hamas and Hezbollah and Iran. You know, we're blasted as well with constant messaging about climate change and the existential threat of that and how the world is coming to an end. It's hard not to have a heightened sense of anxiety in our hearts. We hear about a crisis at our southern border. We, of course, don't even have to hear about it. We all experience extremely high levels of inflation. We witness moral and spiritual decline, like I think we probably could say, like we've never seen before almost. It sure feels that way at times. And we witness, for example, like the radical redefinition of the family and tremendous confusion about identity. These are just a few of the many, many things that cause us in our day to have anxiety, to have this sense of angst and worry and fear. And yet, people of the book, people of God's word, constantly need to come back to the word of God to center themselves on what God says in his word. Psalm 37, verse 1. Fret not yourselves because of evildoers. Jesus in Matthew chapter 6 said, do not worry about your life, what you will eat and what you will drink and what you will wear, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Paul in the New Testament, in the book of Philippians, said, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the God of peace, who guards your hearts and will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You see, the Bible certainly recognizes we're not unique in this. We're not the only people in the history of the world to deal with these kind of matters. When you look in at the world, the people of the first century in the New Testament also had all kinds of things going on around them. That's why the New Testament authors like Paul and certainly Jesus weighed in on those matters, because they knew that anxiousness and fear and worry weigh down the human heart. It's part of our condition that we live in. And long before the time of Jesus, things were happening too in the world, right? There were always things. In fact, since the beginning of time, since creation of the world after the fall of Adam and Eve, we've all been living with this difficult reality. So the Bible tells us, though, that we don't need to be anxious, we don't need to worry, but we so easily can get fixated upon the things of the here and now. And why do we have, what good reason really do we have for not fretting? Or not being afraid, or not worrying? Well, as we continue this series that we started last week in the Old Testament prophets, our text this morning that we've turned to is in the book of Daniel. It's one of the prophets in the Old Testament. Daniel chapter 2 is where we're going to find ourselves this morning. And this text provides the answer, I think. It provides a helpful answer. It's not the full answer, but it certainly is part of the answer. And so again, it's on page 738 in your Bibles that are in the chair. As we begin this study in Daniel chapter 2, I want to begin, first of all, by just setting the context of what's happening in the book of Daniel. King Nebuchadnezzar, who's the king of the Babylonians, they besieged Jerusalem, and they came in and they destroyed not only Jerusalem, but also the temple of the Jews. And they did that in 586 and 587 BC. There are actually three different times that the Babylonians kind of came in. One was in 605 BC, another one was in 597 BC, and then the one where the temple was destroyed was in 586, 87 BC. All historical fact. And what they did is they took a segment of the population of the Jews outside of their homeland, they dragged them off to Babylon, and there they were for 70 years. All part of God's actually design and plan, because at that time, as we heard last week, Israel was living in sin and disobedience and drifted far from God. And though he warned them with prophet after prophet after prophet to turn, they refused to turn back to him. And so he said, finally, I'm going to ultimately have to bring judgment, and the Babylonians will come and they'll take you into exile for 70 years. And there they were. One of the individuals that was taken was Daniel. And so Daniel is coming to us from the perspective of during the exile. You remember maybe last week, if you recall that far ago, it's a long time, it seems like, from now. But there are different types of books that are written in terms of Old Testament. Some that were written before the exile, they're called pre-exilic books. Some that are written after the exile, once they returned out of the 7 years. And then there's the ones that are written or that refer to events that happened in the exile itself. Daniel is one of those books. It's written from the perspective of now we're in Babylon. And to give you the sense of kind of what was going on for them, how difficult this would have been. I mean, can you imagine this in your own life? If somebody came in, a foreign nation, and dragged you off to another place, a completely different language, completely different food, unique culture 100%, they gave you a different education altogether. They had completely different gods that they worshiped, and they required that you would bow down and worship those gods. I mean, can you imagine just a little bit of that? It's hard to almost fathom that, isn't it? So in Psalm 137, we get a bit of a raw picture of what some were feeling as they sat in Babylon. It says in verse 1, "By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion." And we remember what it was like back in Zion, that is back in the Holy Land, what it was like, but we're no longer there. Now we're by the waters of Babylon and we're weeping. On the willows there, that is on the trees, we hung our lyres, that is our musical instruments. For there our captors required of us songs, and our tormentors mirth, saying, "Sing us one of the songs of Zion." How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? And the psalm goes on, and it gets pretty brutal, actually, as you read through the whole psalm, because you see the pain that has come out in this psalm because of the Babylonians and what they did to the Jewish people. But it's out of that pain that you can imagine now you're sitting there for a total of 70 years. You can imagine how hopeless you would feel. You begin to wonder, God, when I look around at the world, like, where in the world are you? Like, this is an absolute mess. I don't even know what to do. You know, for us, we look at the world from a similar kind of lens at times, don't we? But their situation, that's how they were looking at it. And it's at this particular time, somewhere during the 70 years of exile, that God shows up and he gives a dream to the king of Babylon, to King Nebuchadnezzar. And that's what we find in chapter 2. And it's a troubling dream. He describes the dream himself as being troubling. And so what he does is he calls these sort of experts in Babylon to sort of say, I want to know what this dream is all about. So he gathers together the magicians and the enchanters and the sorcerers of Babylon. But he doesn't want them just to say, here's the interpretation of the dream. You see, he's smarter than that. You know, because anybody can sort of fudge the interpretation. Well, king, tell me the dream and I'll tell you the interpretation. You ever do that? Somebody tells you the dream and, well, I think it means this. It means you're going to fall in love with me and you're going to, no, I know it doesn't mean that, right? Like, people come up with all kinds of crazy ideas for interpretations. What this king does, he's smart enough, he says to all his magicians and wise men and sorcerers, no, you tell me the dream that I had. And also tell me the interpretation. You see, because once they could tell the dream, he would know, oh, they're onto it. How else would they have known this dream? And so the individuals that he called to do this are unable to actually tell the king the dream. They say, this is impossible, king. There's no way that anybody could do this. What you're asking for us is way too much. And the king said, if you don't do this, all of you are going to be executed. So they were going to be executed, and Daniel actually was thrown in the mix of all of those individuals because he was kind of like one of those sort of wise guys, you know, a wise guy in a good way. But Daniel said, can you give me a little bit of time? And he gathers his friends. This is all in Daniel chapter 2. He gathers his friends together, and he asks them to pray that God would reveal to him the dream and the interpretation. And then it gets revealed to Daniel. And Daniel in chapter 2 blesses God, and he praises him for being the one who reveals these things. And he requests now to see King Nebuchadnezzar. And he gets in front of King Nebuchadnezzar, and Daniel in his interaction with him has these words to say to the king in Daniel chapter 2, starting in verse 25. I want to read to you just a portion of it. In verse 27, Daniel answered the king and said, no wise man, enchanters, magicians, or astrologers can show the king the mystery that the king has asked. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries, and he has made known to King Nebuchadnezzar what will be in the latter days. Your dream and the visions of your head as you lay in your bed are these. To you, O king, as you lay in bed, came thoughts of what would be after this. And he who reveals mystery made known to you what is to be. You see, Daniel says, you know what, king? Yes, the God of heaven is so unlike the God that you worship. And all the astrologers and the magicians who couldn't do this, my God did do this. And he revealed to me the dream, and he revealed to me the interpretation. And that dream that you had, I can tell you that it has to do with the future. It has to do with the latter days. It has to do with the things that are yet to come. And so Daniel places this dream squarely in the future. And I want you to kind of think about this in the context of those Jews who were, for those years, in exile, hopeless, wondering what God is doing with them, wondering where they are, looking around at the layout of the land and wondering, has God forsaken us? Has he abandoned us? And inserted all of a sudden into the mix of all of this is hope. Is hope. You see, because God chose to reveal himself to the king, something about the future. A future that pertains not only to the Jews of that time, but also to a much greater future. So this morning in this message, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at the dream itself in verses 31 through 36, and then the interpretation that's found in verses 36 to 45. So let's begin, first of all, in verse 31 to 36, Daniel tells the king the dream. He passes on, here's what your dream is, O king. And so I want to read this to you, if you have your Bibles, or it should be on the screen as well. And here it is, starting in verse 31. You saw, O king, and behold, a great image. This image, mighty and of exceeding brightness, stood before you, and its appearance was frightening. The head of this image was of fine gold, and its chest and arms of silver, its middle and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of clay. As you looked, a stone was cut out by no human hand, and it struck the image on its feet of iron and clay and broke them in pieces. Then the iron, the clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold all together were broken in pieces and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away so that there was not a trace that could be found. But the stone that struck the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. So this is the dream that Nebuchadnezzar has that's so terrifying and so frightening to him. And Daniel is now, because God's revealed it to him, God reveals this, and Daniel now communicates to the king, this is your dream. And the king knows that this is his dream. He's had it. He's the one who's experienced it. Now the king knows without question that Daniel is not just some sort of fake or phony, but rather, who could possibly know the secret dreams of another human being like this? And Daniel's clearly testifying to Yahweh, the one true God of the Bible, saying, Yahweh is the revealer of these dreams, O king. That moves us, secondly, in verses 36 to 43, to the interpretation of this dream. Notice in verse 36, Daniel says, this was the dream, what he just finished telling him. Now we will tell the king its interpretation. Pretty straightforward. In the interpretation, Daniel talks about this statue. So he goes in to say, well, listen, in the dream, there's two things that I want to address. First of all, let's talk about the statue. This morning, we're going to talk about this image or the statue that Daniel sees. In the interpretation, Daniel tells King Nebuchadnezzar that the statue actually concerns the rise and the fall of four great empires or four great kingdoms that will come on the earth in the future. Here's what Daniel says. We're going to read it again. Now this is the interpretation starting in verse 37. You, O king, the king of kings, to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power, and the might, and the glory, and into whose hand he has given, wherever they dwell, the children of man, the beasts of the field, and the birds of the heavens, making you ruler or rule over them all, you are the head of gold. Another kingdom inferior to you shall arise after you, and yet a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth. And there shall be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, because iron breaks to pieces and shatters all things. And like iron that crushes, it shall break and crush all these. And as you saw the feet and the toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, it shall be a divided kingdom. But some of the firmness of iron shall be in it, just as you saw iron mixed with the soft clay. And as the toes of the feet are partly iron and partly clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly brittle. And as you saw the iron mixed with soft clay, so they will mix with one another in marriage, but they will not hold together, just as iron does not mix with clay. What Daniel has clearly done here, although the details and the specificity of the various kingdoms, he's clearly talking about four kingdoms here, isn't he? And so I want to sort of just break this down for you to show how historically reliable our text is and how factually anchored our text is, because our text, it is in line with four great kingdoms that came upon the world. In your notes, for example, these four empires or kingdoms that arise are the following. Kingdom number one refers to Babylon. We know this because right away in verses 37 and 38, we know that the first kingdom refers to the kingdom of Babylon because it specifically says so. Daniel says, you, O king, the king of kings, to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power and the might and the glory, and into whose hand he has given, wherever they dwell, the children of man, the beasts of the field and the birds of the heavens, making you ruler over them all. You are the head of gold. So there is no doubt that in this statue, the head of gold in this statue is interpreted to be Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, and this is referring to the kingdom of Babylon. The kingdom of Babylon, the reign of the kingdom of Babylon, stretched from 605 BC, as you can see in your notes, to 539 BC. The second kingdom that's outlined in this passage is known as the Medes and the Persians. The Medes and the Persians. Now you might think, well, this is kind of boring. It's kind of a history lesson, but it's really important because it's leading us to something super important. The Medes and the Persians were from about 539 BC till about 331 BC. This was the next kingdom that came over the earth. And the text specifically says in verse 39, another kingdom inferior to you shall arise after you. So this is the kingdom that follows directly after King Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonians. And then the third kingdom that's outlined, beginning in verse 39, and yet a third kingdom of bronze, which shall rule over all the earth. So this is the third one. It's the Greeks that came. And in 331 BC all the way to 146 BC, the Greeks ruled. Alexander the Great. And then there's the fourth kingdom that's talked about. Friends, I hope you see in this particular prediction or prophecy what was given to King Nebuchadnezzar and interpreted by Daniel, revealed to him by Yahweh, by God himself, is the coming forth of four great kingdoms on the earth. Four kingdoms that nobody could possibly have known were going to come into existence were revealed to King Nebuchadnezzar and interpreted for the king by Daniel. And that fourth kingdom, which stretched out far into the future for Daniel's time period, was the Romans. The Romans who began to rule. And notice it says in our text in verse 40, and there shall be a fourth kingdom. And he describes it, strong as iron, because iron breaks to pieces and shatters all things. And like iron that crushes, it shall break and crush all these. So this fourth kingdom is going to come, and it's going to break and destroy all the sort of the remains and the remnants of all of these other kingdoms that were preceding it. But it's going to be a divided kingdom. Some of the firmness of iron shall be in it, verse 41, just as you saw iron mixed with the soft clay. And then in verse 42, it talks about how there are these toes and the feet of the statue are partly iron and partly clay. So the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly brittle. And then in verse 43, the iron mixed with soft clay indicates that there's going to be a mix with one another in marriage in this kingdom. They will not hold together just as iron does not mix with clay. Now, I will tell you at this juncture that there are other people who kind of approach this text in a little bit different way. Not everybody sees the layout of these four kingdoms in precisely the same way, but most who do see the layout of these kingdoms still conclude that this is about future kingdoms, future to Daniel, that were going to come upon the face of the earth, future to King Nebuchadnezzar that would arise. Now, there is a chart. I'm not sure if they were able to put it on the screen for you this morning, but there is a chart that kind of, I guess, puts this together a little bit for you to be able to see. And you'll notice on the left side of the chart, you have Nebuchadnezzar's dream. And below that, you see the breakdown of the various aspects or portions of the statue, the head, the chest and the arms, the belly and thighs, and so forth. And then you have on the far right side, you have the various kingdoms. What kingdoms were represented by those? So we know these to be true. How? We know them to be true because not only the text, but the text joined up with history. You see, we have a Bible that is anchored in history. It's rooted in history. One of the things, and I'll say this by way of a sidebar, and I don't mean this to be in a bashing way at all, but to point out just facts and realities, we lived in Utah for 18 years. I was a pastor there, a church planter, and I can tell you, having spent significant amount of time in Utah and dealing with the Book of Mormon, that that is a book that has absolutely no historical anchoring whatsoever. I have read numerous books published by them, and I've examined various things, and there's never been a single shred of evidence put forward that actually anchors that book in anything that's historical. There are attempts that are made, but there's nothing that actually shows conclusively. Our Bibles, however, I want to let you know that the amount of archaeological evidence that we have that supports our Bible is phenomenal. I mean, again, many of you or some of you have been to Israel. You've been to Turkey. So have I. I've been to Jordan recently, last October. I've walked through the various sites. I've gone to Jerusalem. I've gone to Bethlehem. I've gone to places on the other side of the Jordan that I open up my Bible and I see and I know. I've seen artifacts. I've been to the museums. There's artifacts that exist that actually have independent and outside of the Bible statements about kings that are mentioned in the Old Testament that attest to the actual historical existence of kings of Israel. I mean, that's just a few of the many, many things about the historical reliability of the Bible. Our Bible is anchored in history. It's rooted in reality. And I don't know about you, but I want what I believe to be rooted in reality. I don't want it to be rooted in mythology. It's rooted in reality. And here in this great text that tells us about the coming of four great kingdoms, this was given to Daniel back in the day when these kingdoms didn't even exist. It attests to the trustworthiness and the reliability of the Word of God. Now, on this chart, you'll also know that Daniel 7 is in the middle. And I wish we had time, but that's for another time when we do a series in the book of Daniel. But Daniel 7 runs parallel to Daniel 2, as you can see if you look down it. This is sort of for you to be able to look at and realize, if you don't know it already, that this also, in another way, talks about those four great kingdoms that are coming on the earth. All of this works together, but our purpose this morning is to take a look at chapter 2. What I want to do at this point, before we go on to the next part of this dream and the interpretation, is simply to ask, what do we learn from this dream and the interpretation about this statue? I've already mentioned the first one, and that is that Yahweh, when I say Yahweh, that is the name for the God of the Old Testament, the God of the Bible. He's the one and true living God. He knows the future, and he plans the future. It's not that he just knows the future. Yes, he's all-knowing, but he also plans the future. He decrees things to pass. Whatever he decrees certainly comes to pass. Nothing can thwart the plan of Almighty God. And he reveals this to Nebuchadnezzar in the dream and Daniel the interpretation long before it happens. The second thing I want you to see from this great statue is that the statue represents actually the kingdoms of this world. There are four of them in this particular text. The kingdom of Babylon, then the Medes and Persians, which were a joined kingdom, and then the Greeks and then the Romans. These are four separate kingdoms, but I don't want us to miss this one great truth, and that they are all represented in one statue. So they're unique and they're different, but they're also the same in this one way. All of them represent the kingdom of man, the kingdoms of this world. They have nothing to do with the kingdom of God in that sense. Do you remember, for example, in the New Testament, what Satan said to Jesus when he was tempting him in the wilderness for 40 days? Satan said to Jesus that, "I will give you all the kingdoms of the world." He showed him all the kingdoms, and he said that, "I will give you all of this and all of their glory. All you have to do is come and worship me." And one asks, how could he even offer that? How could he even offer all the kingdoms of the world? Did he really actually have all of the kingdoms of the world? And the Bible tells us in 1 John 5:19 that Satan is the ruler of this world, meaning little ruler, who is kicked out of heaven, and he roams about on this earth, and he likes to rule with the kingdoms of this world. Behind kingdoms in Scripture, we're not just dealing with the physical reality that there's a king that exists and that there's a government that exists. Oftentimes, biblically, behind the scenes, there is a greater power at work. There's another kingdom that's at work. A kingdom that actually runs counter to the kingdom of God, that is in opposition to the kingdom of God. The kingdoms of this world are usually running counter to God's kingdom. And then thirdly, the four kingdoms, we must point out, are clearly under the sovereign control of God. He is the one in this text in chapter 2 who gives the kings of these kingdoms the authority or the right to rule. Notice this in particular in verse 37 and 38 with Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel says in the interpretation, "You, O king, the king of kings," in other words, there's no other king like you, king, "to whom the God of heaven has given the kingdom." You think that you did this? You think that you're the king? You are the king, but you're the king only because the God of heaven has given you the authority. The God of heaven has given the kingdom, the power, and the glory, and into whose hand he is given wherever they dwell, the children of man, the beasts of the field, and all the birds of heaven, making you rule over them all. If you know anything about the story of King Nebuchadnezzar, you know that after he has this dream interpreted, you would think that his immediate response certainly is like, wow, amazing, at the end of chapter 2. But chapter 3 begins with what? It begins with Nebuchadnezzar constructing a 90-foot-tall statue made out of, guess what? Gold. All gold. You see, his reaction to the dream and the reaction to what God revealed, you would think that he would go, "Yahweh has revealed this unequivocally. It's so crystal clear. How could I not fall down and worship Yahweh, the one true God?" But in his hubris, he builds a 90-foot statue that I can only surmise is about himself. And he calls for everybody to bow down and worship the statue, except for Daniel and his buddies. They won't do that, will they? And they get cast into the fiery furnace. And they trust God when they get cast in. And maybe you know the story, maybe you don't. It's a great story. Here's a guy who says, well, if that statue is made out of the different metals and represent different kingdoms, I'm going to make one made out of gold because I'm the head of gold. Talk about the hubris of man. And so here you have King Nebuchadnezzar, and he does not recognize yet that he's actually under the sovereign control of Yahweh, that God has given him the authority and the right to rule, that he would have none of this if it wasn't granted to him by God. You remember Jesus when he was being interrogated by Pilate in the New Testament? Before Jesus was crucified on the cross, remember the exchange that he had with Pilate, and Pilate basically looked at him and just said, don't you know that I have the authority to have you crucified, to have you executed? And what does Jesus look at Pilate and say? He said, you would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. Who is it who holds all authority and power in his hand? It's Yahweh. It's God himself. Yahweh is the one who causes kingdoms to rise and fall for his sovereign purposes. The king in all of his hubris, people today, leaders today, kings today, governments today, authorities today, nations today, they like to think that they are the ones who do things, that they are unstoppable and unshakable and unmovable, that by their own power and their own authority, their own genius and ingenuity, that they get it done, that they'd accomplished all of this. But the reality is, right here in our text, they would have nothing if it wasn't for the God of heaven who granted them a leash to be able to run with. And God, in all of his sovereignty, is accomplishing his plan. He's moving forward his plan. And I want you to see that from this text, that God was not without plan. That God was not sitting back when Israel was in exile for 70 years going, oh my goodness, what have I done? I don't know what to do next. And writhing his hands and wondering and fiddling and wondering if the kings are going to actually overthrow his great power and authority. No, God was in control the whole time. God had directed it and God was leading it the proper way that he wanted to go. And what the people of God needed to know at that time, in the midst of their hardship and the sufferings, while they were hanging their harps on the willows by the rivers of Babylon, the waters of Babylon, weeping, they needed to remember and be told, there's hope because God is still orchestrating and working out his sovereign plan. So don't give up. When you and I are in the situation we're in now, and you watch the news, and you toggle back and forth from CNN to Fox News, and you wonder if you're being told the truth about absolutely anything, and you wonder which way to go, and what's right and what's wrong, and you wonder where this world is going, regardless of your political views, I don't mean to get into that at all, but regardless of your political views, I think both sort of camps, if you have two camps, both do the same thing. What's happening here? What's going on? The world is coming off of its moorings. It's about to fall off and roll off the edge somewhere. Friends, it's not. It's not without God's sovereign plan that's going to happen. You see, you and I, as followers of Jesus, have the great joy and delight in knowing these things because they anchor us in the midst of all of the insanity. In Greek mythology, maybe you remember Atlas. He's a titan and god of strength and endurance, and perhaps you've seen the depictions of him with the world resting on his shoulders. I mean, he needs to do a little bit more working out. He's kind of a flimsy kind of a guy. The depictions of him, he's a beast of a man. I mean, he's just ripples on ripples upon ripples. And there he is, and he's holding the world up, right? He's doing that. Well, apparently in Greek mythology, that's actually a misconception about Atlas, because that's actually not really true. Well, it's not true anyway, because it's all mythology. But it's not true, you see, because actually the truth of the matter is, in Greek mythology, that Atlas sided with the Titans in their war against the Olympians. And when the Titans were defeated, Atlas was condemned to stand at the edge of the earth and hold up the sky on his shoulders. Not the world. And let's be frank, we're all in trouble if we have to rely on Atlas in the battle of all the Greek mythology gods. And thankfully, we know that this is just mythology. In contrast to this, we have Yahweh, the sovereign Lord of the universe. You remember that old song? He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world. I can't believe I'm singing in front of church. This is terrifying to me. Flav, don't sign me up. No, he's like, don't worry. There's no signing up for you, pal. Yeah. But you know the words. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world. And he's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, sister. He's got the itty-bitty babies in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. It goes on and on. The point is that God is in control of it all. You know, people always don't see this, and they don't always believe this, right? Just like I'm sure back in Babylon, there was times where like, where are you, God? Where are you even in control? Today, people do the same thing. I can tell you the conversations that I have sometimes that I have great delight in having. I have some Jewish friends, and I mention this because it's just important to mention that they're Jewish. Jewish friends that I have conversations with. And when you're sitting at a table and things about the world and current events come up, my key objective is to try everything I can to avoid getting into a political discussion, because I want to be about the gospel, and I don't want them to be distracted by whatever. I want to be about the gospel with them. And yet what I will do when they say that it's a mess and it's terrible and what's going on, and I know that they come from a different perspective than I do, and I don't engage it, what I do engage is this, is I say, you know what? What I find really helpful for me is to remember that Hashem, Amen. Which is Hebrew for the name, yes. Which means God, that Hashem is in control. And I can tell you that on one completely different occasion, a particular individual looked at me and said, I don't believe that. And I said, I'm at a loss. How is it that you don't believe this? But you go to the synagogue, and don't you believe in the scriptures? Don't you believe that? I mean, Hashem is all over the scriptures. He's in control. He's the Lord of the universe. I don't believe that. On a completely different occasion, with the same group that I sit with periodically, there was another individual with a different conversation, and that individual, when I said that, you know, God is in control of all things, this individual said, well, I don't see that anywhere. I don't see that anywhere. And I said to him, I said, listen, like, I understand that. I can see how you'd look around and say, well, God, where are you? But here's the thing, what I reminded him of, let's go back to the scriptures. You're a Jew. Let's go back to the Word of God. That I don't know if you really believe in. But let's go back to it. You think about what Israel did. Israel was given by God great blessing, and they were brought into the promised land, and God promised them if they followed him, they would be blessed, that they would have great prosperity in the land, that they would flourish, and yet God warned them in advance, but if you deviate from it, you turn, and you begin to sacrifice your children to false gods, and you begin to do all of the abominable practices of the nations that were in that land, which were quite horrific, frankly, if you look at them in terms of bestiality and all kinds of things like that. If you go in and you do that, know this, that I will drag you off into exile. I will punish you, but I will bring you back again. I will bring you back again. And so what we have here in this account, what we have, when I say this to the individual, is to remind him that you know why you don't see God sometimes? It's because, unfortunately, and I don't point out any individual, it's unfortunately that for over a long period of time, you know what we've done to God here? We've basically said this, and we've kicked him to the curb. And we basically said, you know where you can go. And not everybody's done that. But friends, let's be frank about it. I mean, we're a nation that in many respects is far from God. Far from God. And we've exchanged the worship of God for the worship of all kinds of other things. And then we wonder, when things are hard and difficult, and when the world starts to unravel or has the appearance of unraveling, what's the response of so many people? Well, if there is a God, then where in the world is he? He's right there, friends. He's right there. But you see, here's the thing with God, as we see in Old Testament scripture, that God gives the people what they want. It's called handing them over. In the book of Judges, that's exactly what happened. The people made their decision, and God handed them over. Because he wasn't going to absolutely impose his will and force it on them. He said, if you want that, then fine, go and have it. And the period of judges in Israel was one of the most horrific times in ancient Israel, where everybody did what was right in their own eyes. And yet God in his mercy and love was doing what? Always through the prophets as time unfolds, calling the people back, calling his unfailing, his undying love for the people. It was always saying, come back, repent, turn. You can always escape this because I love you. You are my treasured possession. So that's what we have here in this particular text. We have these four kingdoms that are depicted. And we have a God who's truly in control. But there's one more thing in this dream to underscore. Because there's a fifth kingdom that has nothing to do with the statue. And it's depicted as a stone. As a stone in verse 44 and 45. And I want us to read this in Daniel chapter 2 because of this stone that's in verse 45. I want you to notice that this is not made with all these different metals that are cherished and precious to the world around them, that the world would say, oh, gold and silver and iron and bronze. No, bronze, this is a stone. This is a little insignificant, small stone that's cut out of a mountain. That's it. It's this little stone. And God always seems to use that which is small and insignificant to accomplish his purpose. We look at the things that are big and bright and shiny and think this is the way to do it. And God says, no, I have a different way. I have a different way. The kingdoms of man is like that, but the kingdom of God is different. Notice this in Daniel chapter 2 in the interpretation in verse 44 and 45 with regards to this fifth kingdom, this stone. He says, and in the days of those kings, in the days of those kings, he's referring to the last kingdom, Rome, the Romans. In my view, he's referring to specifically the various kings in the different provinces of Rome. Interpreters, you'll find, will differ in their particular opinion on this. They are trying to understand carefully history. But it is without doubt in the days of the Romans. In the days of the Romans, in the days of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. It shall break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever. Just as you saw, and here he is picking up on the dream, just as you saw that a stone was cut from the mountain by no human hand, and that it broke in pieces the iron and the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold. A great God has made known to the king what he shall be after this. The dream is certain, and its interpretation is sure. What is going on in this passage? This is truly a remarkable passage for us. You see, in this passage, the stone that's described here is referring to this fifth kingdom that would be launched, that would begin during the days of the Romans. In Luke chapter 2, it was in the days of Caesar Augustus that he issued a decree that a census should be taken of all the inhabited land. Why? Because God in his appointed time, when the fullness of time had come, Galatians 4:4, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. You see, the stone here that's described in this is a stone that's not part of the statue or of the image. It's not. It's different from that. It's from outside, isn't it? It's not of the kingdom of man. In fact, it's clearly stated to be the kingdom of God. It's not a kingdom from this world. It's otherworldly. It specifically says of this stone that it was cut by no human hand actually cut this. Rather, it was carved out of the mountain, and that stone is thrown at the mountain, the kingdom of man, and the kingdom of man is destroyed. You see, it is of divine origin, this stone. And the stone destroys the entire statue. It becomes, as we see in Daniel chapter 2, when he first hears the dream says of this stone that the stone struck the image and it became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. All of this points to the arrival of God's kingdom. His kingdom, we're told, will never be destroyed or left to another people. His kingdom, we're told, will break and bring to an end all other kingdoms of this world. His kingdom, we are told, is not of this world. So what's going on here? Well, during the days of the Roman Empire, God did set up his kingdom. He sent forth his son into this world, and he established his kingdom. I want you to consider, for example, what Jesus said at the beginning of his ministry. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, Jesus began to preach, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." In chapter 4, verse 23, it says that he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel or the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. In Matthew chapter 13, as he gave parables of the kingdom, a series that we went through as a church not too long ago, he told this parable. He said, "The kingdom of heaven, it may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came and said to him, 'Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds?' He said to them, 'An enemy has done this.' So the servant said to him, 'Then do you want us to go and gather them?' But he said, 'No, lest in gathering the weeds, you root up the weed along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.' And then he told him another parable. 'The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed that a man took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it is grown, it is larger than all the garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches,' which is actually language drawn right out of Daniel chapter 4 about the kingdom of God, and that when the kingdom of God grows and expands, the nations of the world and the people of the world find shade in the kingdom. You see, the kingdom that Jesus preached was not the kingdom of man or the kingdom of this world. His kingdom refers to the rule of God, the reign of God. He is king. We call him King Jesus. He started the kingdom. It started like a mustard seed, the smallest of seeds, but it's grown and grown and grown from the time of its inception when Jesus came into this world, and it continues to grow, and it's grown into a tree, so that the birds of the air, that is the people of all nations of the world, will come and they will rest in its branches. In the words of Daniel 2, verse 35, that stone that comes, the kingdom of God that struck the image, it ends up filling the whole earth. You see, this is the beauty of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is not confined to a territory, a border, an ethnicity. Rather, it transcends all of that. It's for all people, for all times, for all places, the kingdom of God throughout all the earth. The kingdom of God centers on the person of Jesus, who's the king. And Jesus himself said to people, "The kingdom of God is within you." But is it, my friend? Is the kingdom of God within you? In other words, has God's rule taken up, has he taken up rule in your life? In order for that to happen, you have to know Jesus. You have to invite Jesus Christ into your life. You have to accept who he is, what he did for you, and his death on the cross for your sins, his burial, and his resurrection. And when you do that, he comes into your life. He is the king who now conquers you, your little kingdom. And you say, "Jesus, I gladly yield to you as my king." All hail, King Jesus, we sing. All hail, Emmanuel. Why do we sing that? Because he rules and reigns in us. It has to start with us. That's where the kingdom of God begins. And that kingdom, we're told, will never be destroyed in this text. And Jesus himself in John 18, 36, he said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would be fighting." And oh, how we see that today. The kingdoms of this world always in a struggle. But he said that I might not be delivered over to the Jews, but my kingdom is not from the world. It's another kingdom. Friends, Jesus calls you and I to his kingdom. That's what he's called us to do. You know the number one theme in the entire gospel, all the gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? It's the kingdom of God. Jesus is king, and he's inviting you to be part of his kingdom. I've always found, and if I could put it this way, I've always found as a man, and I'm just speaking, of course, because a vantage point from a man, because I'm a man. I don't know how else to speak. So I'll speak from a vantage point of a man because I am one. I find that message to be truly gripping and compelling. I'm not being called to some effeminate, emasculated Jesus. I'm being called to the King. And I know of no greater King to bow down to. I've known of no one else that I can ever imagine pledging my allegiance to getting on my knees and saying, Jesus, I pledge it all to you as a man. And you know what? Every man's heart, in my view, is best served when they bow the knee to King Jesus and say, King Jesus, you rule and you reign. You come into my life, please. I need you to conquer this kingdom. I don't want to be a man of hubris. I don't want to be a man who lives for himself, who builds his own kingdom. At the end of days, he finds that that kingdom is useless. It's worthless. Rather, Jesus, may your kingdom come in me and rule and reign in me. But to do that, one needs Jesus. And so I would say to you today, if you're here and you don't know who Jesus is, and maybe you're exploring that, please ask questions. Please find out. We want to tell you about Jesus, who he is, and what he's done for you, and how you can have a relationship with the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. Friends, that's the kingdom that was predicted and promised for hundreds of years and came to pass with great precision. And it's not over yet. Because there's a form of the kingdom in its final stage that will come when Jesus finally comes back and makes this whole world new again. And all of the troubles and all the heartache and all the suffering and the pain and the sorrow will all be put aside. So this morning, we have a great opportunity to remember Jesus as our King as we come forward for communion. If you know Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, you know, I've accepted Jesus Christ. He's your King. And Jesus told us that we should gather together and that we should remember what he's done for us. And we do that when we take communion together. Nothing magical or mystical about the bread and the cup that's here in front of you on these two tables. These are symbols that help us remember. The cup reminds us that Jesus died and his blood, he actually died and bled for us. He gave up his life. The bread represents his body hung on the cross for us. We take these and we take them in remembrance. And with gratitude, we say, Lord, thank you for doing this for me, that I can have salvation. We take it as men and women who are part of the kingdom to say, thank you, Lord, for rescuing me from the kingdom of darkness and bringing me into the kingdom of your beloved Son. And so we do so not in a somber sense and a mournful sense, but rather with joy we come forward. I want to encourage you, as the worship team leads us, to come forward and to take from either table, the cup and the bread, and then just make your way back to your seats, and then Pastor Flav will lead us in the taking of communion together. But I want to pray first. Father, thank you for your word. We love you, Lord. Thank you that we can worship you. And thank you, Lord, that we can partake in this communion in Jesus' name. Amen. Please come forward.